If you have your Bibles this evening, we're going to be in the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 2, looking at verses 8 to 11. Revelation chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. And we get there, if you are able, please stand for the reading of God's word. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna, write the words of the first and the last, who died and came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the slander of those who say that they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested. And for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. This is God's word, and he has written it to us for our good. You may be seated. Let's pray and ask for the Lord's help to hear the preaching of his word. Heavenly Father, we confess that we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. We thank you for your word. And how you have given it to us as a gift to show us the way of salvation, to show us your glory, to show us how we might live lives pleasing to you, and ultimately to show us the beauty and majesty of your Son. We pray that you would open our eyes so that we might behold wonderful things in your law. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. I want to start off our time with a question, and the question is this: what makes a church successful? What makes a church successful? How do you determine if a church is healthy or not? Is it the size of the building, the amount that is in the budget, the number of people who attend on a Sunday morning or evening? Or is it the number of things that a church is involved in? In these seven letters that Jesus gives to his seven churches, in Revelation chapters 2 and 3, we find what Christ values in a church and how he describes and defines success and health. And as you move through these letters one by one, you'll notice that Jesus' determination of success and health has almost nothing to do with the various metrics that we tend to use. And perhaps the most famous and clearest of examples is found in the church of Smyrna, because this little church that is suffering through extreme poverty, a church that has no influence in the city, no money, a very small membership, and very few ministry initiatives on its website, is considered to be a church that Jesus views as successful and healthy. This church that is insignificant in the eyes of the world is viewed as great in the eyes of Christ. As you scan these few verses, you notice that Jesus has no word of correction, no word of rebuke, unlike what he has for several of the other churches in these letters. There is no call to repentance. He simply tells them to keep going, to keep doing what they are doing. He encourages them not to fear, but to be faithful to him in the midst of fierce opposition and persecution. Now, in order to understand something of our text this morning or this evening, we need to know something about the city of Smyrna. First, Smyrna was a city that was about 25 miles or 35 miles north of Ephesus. And like Ephesus, Smyrna was a prosperous city. It is what you would call a seaport town. It did not have the same mighty population like cities like Ephesus, but it was still a large and substantial city. It was known, first of all, for its beautiful architecture. It boasted in having some of the most beautiful and impressive buildings in all of Asia Minor. And Smyrna was also a city that was extremely loyal to the Roman Empire. Even before Rome became a world power, the city of Smyrna had built a temple to the goddess of Rome. When several cities were bidding for the honor of building a temple to the Roman Emperor Tiberius, Smyrna alone secured this opportunity and built a temple for the emperor. But in this prosperous city, the city that was and very much was making a name for itself, there were Christians whose lives in Smyrna that were extremely difficult. It was difficult because Smyrna was a pagan city that did not tolerate Christians. In Smyrna, it was offered or required for all to offer sacrifices to the emperor to treat him like a god, to say that the emperor was Lord. And so, these Christians are being persecuted for their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. They were, in many cases, losing their property, being excluded from the business of the city, and even being thrown into jail because they refused to bow the knee to the emperor. It wasn't that they simply worshiped Jesus, but it is that they worshiped Jesus alone and therefore declare that the gods of the Roman Empire were no gods at all. It was the exclusivity of Jesus that got them into trouble. You see, most people aren't bothered about hearing anyone say that they worship Jesus Christ, but the temperature gets slightly warmer when they learn that we believe that Jesus alone is worthy of worship. That Jesus isn't one of many gods, but that he is the only God. You can imagine that these believers are weary, they're exhausted, they're fearful, maybe even discouraged, and perhaps they're wondering if following Jesus is really worth it. And it is in this context that Jesus sends this letter through the pen of the Apostle John and encourages this small but yet faithful church to keep pressing on. And notice how Jesus introduces himself in verse 8. He says, "And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write, the words of the first and the last, who died and came to life." Jesus declares himself to be the first and the last, the one who died and at the same time is now very much alive. These two descriptions that Jesus gives are meant to communicate his eternality and his victory over death. First, his eternality. When Jesus says that he is the first and the last, he is declaring that he was there in the beginning before everything else existed, and he will still be there when everything else fades away. That he was before all worlds, and what he is today, he will be until the end of time. This is a reference to Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6, where the Lord, through the prophet Isaiah, says these words, "Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and the last. Besides me, there is no God." What a significant amount of encouragement and comfort it would be to this small, struggling church To know that Jesus is eternal, because it also means that Jesus is unchangeable, that he is immovable, that he does not grow weary, and he does not grow old, that he was God before they were born, and he will still be God as they pass into eternity, that earthly empires will come and go, but Christ will remain. And this eternal Christ has loved his people with an eternal love. How can you know that the love of Christ will not end one day? It's because Christ himself will not end. And here is where this would be particularly encouraging for these believers, that they can be assured that their suffering and persecution will one day come to an end because Christ and his love will outlast their present situation. Beloved, your Savior, the one who has bled and died for you, is able to keep you eternally because he himself is eternal. But not only is he eternal, but here is also where it gets good. He is victorious over death. Jesus introduces himself as one who has died and came back to life. And of course, this speaks of his death and resurrection. Jesus Christ, the eternal Son of God, died in the place of sinners, and his lifeless body was laid in a borrowed tomb. And this tomb was borrowed because Jesus wouldn't need this tomb for long. Because after 3 days, Jesus would be raised from the dead. That death could not hold the Son of God. And the empty tomb is the visible proof that Christ has conquered death in our stead. That Christianity is true and real and worth it because Christ has conquered death, hell, and the grave. And he has risen to say, according to Revelation chapter 1, that I am the living one. I died, but look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and the grave. You see, Jesus is telling his church that the worst thing that could happen to them has already happened to him. That these believers need not fear death because Jesus Christ has defeated death on their behalf. There's a story that's often told by the great Presbyterian minister, Donald Gray Barnhouse, who was the pastor of the historic 10th Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia from the 1920s to the 1960s. The story is that Donald Gray Barnhouse's first wife died of cancer in her late 30s, leaving Barnhouse to raise 4 of their children who were younger than 12 alone. And as he was driving to the funeral with his 4 children in the car, a large truck pulls next to them in the left lane, and it casts its shadow over the car. In that moment, Barnhouse asked his children, "Would you rather be run over by the truck or by the shadow of the truck?" His 11-year-old daughter responded rather quickly, "By the shadow, of course." And Barnhouse, like the good preacher that he is, responds, "Well, that's what happened to your mother. Only the shadow of death passed over her because the truck of death ran over the Lord Jesus Christ." Beloved, that's what Jesus is saying to his church. The shadow of death is upon them, but they need not fear because Jesus Christ took upon himself the sting of death and has been raised from the dead, proving himself victorious. And Jesus is encouraging this church to press on, to continue to be faithful, to persevere, to remember the one that they are suffering for. And after encouraging this church with this introduction, Jesus tells them 3 things. He first tells them that he knows their suffering. He then tells them, do not fear. And then he tells them to be faithful unto death. He knows their suffering. They do not need to fear, and they are called to be faithful unto death. So first, he tells them that he knows their suffering. Take a look at what Jesus says in verse 9. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich. And the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Jesus starts by telling these Christians that he knows their tribulation. When he spoke to the church in Ephesus, he told them that he knows their works. But here he says that he knows their troubles. The same Jesus who sees our work on his behalf also sees the troubles that we experience. The word tribulation is another word, a way of saying affliction or their oppression. Again, the Christians in Smyrna were being persecuted for their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It wasn't that people merely disliked them, but is that they were intentionally being targeted because they would not and could not bow to the Roman gods. And we're told the specific ways they are being persecuted. They are suffering poverty and they are being slandered. First, they are suffering poverty. The city of Smyrna was prospering, as we said earlier, but it seems that the Christians there were not able to benefit from this prosperity, or that they were intentionally being excluded from the prosperity of the city. And it appears that this poverty was severe. Historically, we know that this poverty was mainly due to at least three causes. First, many of these believers were having their property confiscated and their goods stolen by hostile neighbors. We see an example of something like this in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 34, where we read that those Christians had compassion on those in prison, and they joyfully accepted the plundering of their property, since they knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. The second cause was that these believers were having a hard time succeeding financially in a hostile and pagan environment. In these days, workers belong to what was known as trade guilds. It's similar to labor unions today. And in many cases, in order to participate in these guilds, you would have to offer sacrifices to the gods of those guilds. That you would have to participate in the various pagan religious ceremonies, and to choose not to would significantly hinder you financially. And the third cause is that some in this church were facing prison time and possible death, and this, of course, would have severe financial consequences, both for them and also for their family. But notice that in acknowledging their poverty, Jesus tells them that they are rich. How can Jesus say to this church that doesn't have two nickels to rub together, a church that's not simply poor, but in the words of my grandfather, a church that is po, how can he say that they are rich? He can say that they are rich because they have him. That everything else can be taken away from them. They can lose their property. They can be removed from their land. They can be excluded from these trade guilds. But what cannot be taken away from them is the Lord Jesus Christ. That he is the pearl of great price. That he is the crown jewel. That he himself indeed is the treasure. Beloved, the only way that you are ever going to be faithful in suffering for Jesus is if you believe the Lord Jesus Christ is actually worth it. That you must be able to affirm with the Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 3, indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ. Not only are they suffering from poverty, but they also are suffering from being slandered. Jesus mentions that this church is being slandered by those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. The only people who were exempt in the Roman Empire from worshiping the gods of the Roman Empire were the Jewish people, because the Jewish people were fiercely committed to monotheism, to worship of one God. And so Rome allowed for them to continue to do this. But the problem was that was many of the Jews were becoming Christians, that they came to believe that Jesus was the promised Messiah. And so many non-believing Jews, in seeking to distance themselves from the Christians, would report them to the Roman government, exposing that these Christians were not submitting to the emperor's reign. History tells us that there were even accusations concerning cannibalism and the drowning of babies because of false understandings of the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper. And this would lead to more and more persecution. Jesus goes as far as to say that they say they are Jews, but they are not. It's similar to what he says to the Jewish religious leaders in John chapter 8, where he tells them that if they were truly Abraham's children, then they would believe in him. In Romans chapter 2, verses 28 to 29, Paul says something similar. He writes, "For no one is a Jew who is merely one outwardly, nor is circumcision outward and physical. But a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the letter." And Jesus takes it a step further and even says that they are a synagogue of Satan. Now, we have to be careful here, because this phrase, in many cases, has wrongly been interpreted throughout history and has led to atrocious acts and vile speech to our Jewish friends and neighbors. And each and every time this is done, it is sin and it is a twisting of the Lord Jesus Christ's words. Remember, the one who says these words is a Jewish man, one who comes from a Jewish family. So he's not disparaging the Jewish people. So what is he saying? Well, he's saying that these Jewish people who are persecuting his church are actually doing the work of Satan. That they believe themselves to be doing the work of God, but they are not doing the work of God. They are doing the work of Satan. He's reminding these Christians that, yes, it's this group of Jewish people who are making your life difficult, but ultimately, it is Satan who is against you. Jesus tells these struggling believers that he knows their situation. If you've ever suffered any amount of time, then you know that the hardest part of suffering is when you begin to believe that no one understands your situation. But hear me. Jesus is saying that he knows and he understands, that you have a Savior who gets it. But not only does Jesus tell them that he knows their suffering, but he also tells them, do not fear. And this brings us to our second point, do not fear. Take a look at verse 10. Jesus says, "Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation." Jesus, in essence, says to these suffering Christians, "I know that it is bad, but it is about to get worse." He says, "The devil is about to throw some of you into prison, and for 10 days you will have tribulation." I personally believe that those 10 days are not literal, but it's much more like the rest of the book of Revelation in that it is symbolic. That like the number 10, like the number 7, often speaks of wholeness or completeness. It's an allusion or a reference back to the book of Daniel. And in Daniel chapter 1, verses 12 to 15, Daniel makes a decision to not eat from the pagan king's table so that he might not defile himself. And he tells the chief of the king's staff to test him and his friends for 10 days. Only give us vegetables and water and see if we are able to keep up. These 10 days tested Daniel's faithfulness and commitment to the Lord, that he refused to bow down to the pagan king. And on the other side of that testing, we read that Daniel and his friends were better in appearance and fatter in flesh than all the youths who ate the king's food. And this is what is taking place in our text this evening. These Christians will be tested. They will be thrown into prison and experience tribulation, but on the other side of that, their faith will be strengthened and they will give a powerful testimony to the sustaining power of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus simply tells them, do not fear what you are about to suffer. Jesus knows that they are already afraid, that they are already fearful, so he speaks a word of comfort to them. He says, beloved, do not fear. The command not to fear is one of the more frequent commands in Scripture. I'm not sure how many times it's commanded, but I know it's pretty frequent, and that's because you and I are so prone to fear, especially during moments of suffering and persecution, that we are so tempted to be afraid of those who seem to be stronger than we are. We fear the loss of our reputations. We fear what others might think of us if they really knew what we believed. When the temperature is turned up in the room, our hearts are filled with questions concerning what might happen if they really knew I believe this. Jesus addresses this in Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. He says to his disciples, do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both the body and the soul in hell. What Jesus is saying is that our fear of him should surpass our fear of anyone else. And notice in this command of do not fear, Jesus makes a strong statement concerning his sovereignty over suffering. He says this will last 10 days. He's saying that there is a limited amount of time concerning their suffering. In other words, Jesus knows when their suffering is going to come to an end. We are not to fear suffering because Jesus is sovereign over suffering. Beloved, when we suffer, when we experience persecution or any other type of suffering as we live life in a fallen world, we need to know that Jesus still has everything under control, that his hand is still on the steering wheel. And his purpose in the fiery trial is not that we would be consumed, but that we would be refined like gold. Listen to how this is framed in the hymn, How Firm a Foundation. Fear not, I am with thee, O be not dismayed, for I am thy God, and I will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand, upheld by my righteous, omnipotent hand. When through the deep waters I call you to go, the rivers of sorrow shall not overflow. For I will be near thee, thy troubles to bless, and sanctify to thee thy deepest distress. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only design thy dross to consume, and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus has leaned for repose, I will not desert to its foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no never, no never forsake. Beloved, Jesus tells us this evening, do not fear. Jesus tells them that he knows their suffering. He tells them, do not fear. And lastly and briefly, he says, be faithful unto death. Be faithful unto death. Take a look at that last part of verse 10. Jesus says, be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. Jesus is encouraging these saints not to give up, to continue in their faithfulness to them, to him, to continue to press on even in the midst of difficulty. And notice how he motivates them to press on. He reminds them of the eternal reward that awaits them. I will give you the crown of life. In Smyrna, the city center was considered to be its crown. It was designed in such a way that as you looked up into the hills, it was almost this picture of the crown that would look down over the sea. And also in Rome, if you were invited to a special banquet, you would be given a laurel or a flowery crown to signify your exalted status at this eloquent banquet. And what Jesus is saying to his church is that I know it's hard. I know it's difficult. I know you're tired. But if you endure, if you are faithful to death, then I have a crown of glory, a crown of life that surpasses the cheap and fading crowns of places like Smyrna and Rome offer you. Beloved, the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed to us on the day of Christ Jesus on our Lord. For on that day, the Lord Jesus Christ is going to make all things right. That on that day, you and I will be raised from the dead and we will have resurrected bodies. On that day, we will have every one of our tears wiped away. We will, according to verse 11, not be hurt by the second death. We will see the children that we lost, both adult children and the children that died in infancy. And most important of all, we will see Jesus. We will behold him as he is. And 1 John tells us that we will become like him. And we will dwell with our God forever and ever. That this is the eternal joy that awaits us. That if there is one discipline that I can encourage you to add to your Christian life, it is this. Meditate on the hope of heaven every chance you get. That take time to write down the beautiful passages of Scripture that lay before us our eternal reward and meditate on those things again and again and again. About 60 years after this letter from Jesus arrives at the church in Smyrna, there was an old prisoner in the Roman Empire by the name of Polycarp. Polycarp was a disciple of John, and he was an overseer of the church in Smyrna. And at this time, Polycarp is about 86 years old. And when the Roman governor told Polycarp that if he were to curse Christ and offer sacrifices to Rome, then he would be freed. The governor even went as far as to beg Polycarp to abandon his faith in Christ and not die because Polycarp was so old. And Polycarp responded with these famous words. He says, 86 years have I served him, and he has done me no wrong. How then can I now blaspheme my King and Savior? How could Polycarp say those words? How could he be faithful unto death? It's likely because he heard these words from Jesus that we read in our text. That he remembers sitting with the rest of the congregation, getting the letter, and hearing Jesus say to the church in Smyrna, "I know your suffering. Do not fear. Be faithful unto death, and I will have a crown of glory that awaits you." Beloved, what makes a church successful? According to our text, the church is successful when it's faithful to Christ, no matter the cost. May the Lord make it so here among his people. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these words from Christ. Words that both comfort and at the same time challenge us. Words that both build us up and at the same time expose us. And we thank you for the encouragement that is found in these words. We thank you that Christ has been raised from the dead, and because of that, we have no reason to fear death. But we also confess that very often we can be a fearful people. So we pray that you would encourage our hearts, that you would strengthen our faith, and that you would lay before us the eternal rewards of heaven again and again, so that we might be faithful to you here in the present. We ask all of this in the strong and mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, friends, let's stand and receive the Lord's benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with and abide with you all, both now and forevermore. Amen.